All right. Shalom, everyone. There's another video I make here in public again. Well, it's beautiful weather today. It's already fall now as season, but it is summer weather today. There you have the sun above the flat earth. All right. Good. Guys, I want to talk with you guys about the mindset of separation. I call it the mindset of separation, but it's really what Jesus said. If your eye, Jesus said the eye, I mean your vision is the lamp of the body. And Jesus also asked the rhetorical question, if that what should be light in you is darkness, and how great is the darkness? I want to elaborate on that for a while. You see, when you think in separation from Christ, in separation from the Most High, that's darkness. Why? Because it's a lie. It's not true. It's not real. And look, when someone's way of thinking is darkness, when they think in separation from Christ, then they basically, that's a pagan way of thinking. I'm not saying immediately that they are pagans, that they are involved in, in organized religion, or with human sacrifices, or with astrology, or with tarot cards. I'm not saying that. But that mindset, the worldly mindset, is a pagan mindset. It's based upon a fictive separation between God and the creation. It's based upon accusation against the Most High also. And it basically is suggesting to you that you have to have a knowledge of both wrong and right in order to determine for yourself what's best for you on your terms. And don't think about it, guys. If someone's mindset is in separation, then everything they perceive, they will filter it through separation. And if they process everything through separation, then all the conclusions they will come to will be dark conclusions. So an impure human, because you are impure, you have an impure mind, an impure human cannot come to pure conclusions. They can't. They simply can't. There's no possibility for them to do it. So look, when unbelievers, and unfortunately sometimes also believers, when they go through, how would I say, when they go through traumatic experiences, and they begin to ask the question, why did God allow this to happen, or why does a loving God allow evil, or why does a loving God send people to hell? You know, I've formulated three questions that are quite popular among the accusers of God. Okay, now be careful with these questions. Okay, and I'm going to analyze these questions. First question was, why did God allow this to happen? Now, okay, they call him God, not Father or Lord. God, some that means he's abstract, he's far, he's distant. So how they formulate him is already at this, already distant, cold. Narcissistic, basically, because they're only focused on themselves. Why did God allow this to happen? What is this? This is something that's not in line with their thinking of separation. So basically, their whole question, why did God allow this to happen, is basically suggesting that the Most High is not interested in them. It's either also a suggestion that the Most High, for some reason, failed, or is doesn't want to admit fault. He doesn't have any fault. And also a way of projecting. Why? Because the sinner is basically projecting on the Most High his own defect of self-centeredness. The next question, how can a loving God send people to hell? Now, first of all, there's another separation in this question. Why would a loving God? They didn't say, why does the Father send? Why they don't say, why does the Father send people to hell? that question would be a little bit more legitimate, wouldn't it? But no, they say, why would a loving God? A loving God. So according to them, there are multiple gods. And they have the adjective, where they have the noun, loving. So what is loving according to them? They say, why would he allow X to happen? Why would he do X? So according to them, X, they're sending people to hell, is not loving. So they are basically showing their defect of self-centeredness, and they're projecting it on Christ. And now, there are Christians that try to answer these questions. But I'm here to tell you, you cannot answer those questions, because those questions are they have a perception of darkness. I've said it. Their perception is darkness. The only thing they are willingly to process is darkness. To process truth, they have to repent. They will have to give up. They're not willing to do that. So they want to stick into the dark. And they expect an answer that's in darkness to feel good about themselves. So when you explain the gospel to them, when you explain the sacrifice of Christ, when you explain all of that, they are still not satisfied. Why? Because their focus is in darkness. So this is also something Christ said: do not give us holy unto dogs, and do not throw your pearls before swine. Well, if someone's perception is darkness, and they are aware of this, because trust me, or trust the word, people are aware that their mindset is in separation, or as we say, in darkness. But they persist in that perception. They want to feel good about their self-centeredness. So in order to feel good about their self-centeredness, they will have to blame someone else so that they won't have to take responsibility. So when people come with questions that are formulated in darkness, or they come with an attitude and with a tone that's formulated in darkness, what I've learned during the years is to do the same as Jesus did. He's either answering parables, or ask them a question in return that they cannot answer, or simply ignore them and walking away. You see, some people say, Rashid, the lesson you're doing is very cruel. What if they were earnestly seeking for God? Now listen, Jesus Christ, God himself, when he walked the earth, there were so many people coming with questions to him, but most of them had no interest in the Most High at all. They had no interest in salvation, they had no interest in truth at all. Most only came because they heard things that appeared to confirm their own bias. And because they wanted to confirm their own bias, because they certainly didn't want to repent, didn't want to give up their self-centeredness, didn't want to admit that they might be wrong, that would wound their pride. So they came to Jesus, but not with a willingness to receive truth, but with a hardened heart against the truth of God. And with a hardened heart, that means they persist in negativity, they persist in darkness. Think about the rich young ruler. That guy was probably in his 30s or maybe his late 20s. Because still, you're 40 years old, you were considered young by the Hebrews. So he probably was somewhere in his 30s or late 20s. He had a lot of money. And during the Roman Empire, if you had a lot of money in Palestine, in that area, man, you were the man. So in order for you to be rich under the Roman rule, you had to also be friendly towards the Roman mythology, Greek mysticism. You had to be also friendly and in agreement with paganism. Because if you were not, then the Roman government would rob you of your wealth. That's how they robbed many Hebrews from their land, and many Hebrews became poor. That's why many Hebrews, even before the Roman Empire was declared, when it was still the Roman Republic, when it was still a part of the Greek Empire, many Hebrews, Judeans, they fled to Western Africa. Around 1 million. That's before King Herod became king, before Augustus became emperor of Rome. During the time that Jesus walked the earth, there were also many Hebrews still fleeing to Western Africa, from Nigeria till basically Ghana. You see, that was basically the place where many Hebrews fled to, far from Roman dominance, you see? And the thing is, guys, this rich young ruler, he didn't flee. He could have traveled to, Western Africa. where there were many Hebrews in their villages and in their cities. There were about 2 million when Jesus walked the earth around there. But he chose to remain within the empire. As a Hebrew young man with a lot of money, he could have traveled to Ireland. Ireland, which was called Hibernia. Hibernia comes from Iber. Iber is basically where you get the word Hebrew from. So Hibernia is the land of the Hebrews, and it was a famous destination in ancient times for the Israelites. So you had many Israelite communities, Israelite villages in Ireland in ancient times, also in Britain. So as a rich young ruler, he could have easily decided, I don't want to take Roman rule, I'm going to Ireland. And Britain was not subjected by Rome yet. But the fact alone that he remained in Palestine showed that he was in agreement with paganism and with the empire. So why am I telling all this history? Because you need to understand the context in which it's happening. And that's the problem often. Often we read stuff from scripture but don't have the context. We don't understand it. So we come up with our own conclusions based on our past experiences, or we listen to the explanations of teachers that are often influenced by Greek Greco-Roman mythology. You see? So that's why I explain history when I tell things about scripture. So this rich young ruler was in agreement with paganism, was in agreement with Rome and Greece. And in order to be rich in that time, you had to be a bastard or an asshole by robbing other people. You see? I'm just being real here. Because the scribes, which we see the lawyers and the Pharisees and Sadducees, they did the same thing. They loved money. They claimed they loved Yahweh, but they loved money. Okay, so this man that loves money, he's been exploiting people, he's been ignoring reality, he's been agreeing with Satan basically. He comes to Jesus and he says, good teacher, what must I do to earn eternal life? Or he didn't just ask him once, he kept coming up to Jesus. In Luke, you can read, Master, what must I do to earn eternal life? So you see, so he called Jesus good, but it was only a good teacher, a rabbi he called them, not Lord. So he did not want to acknowledge who Jesus really is. That didn't even come into his mind. He didn't want that. He called them a good master, like a guru, someone that has achieved something in life and you want to be inspired to achieve it for yourself. It's a pagan idea. And Jesus was the one that was good in the sense that Jesus could benefit his self-centeredness. And look at how Jesus answered him. Why do you call me good? There's none good but God alone. What he said was basically a rebuke against men from, hold on a minute. You have your version of good that's pagan. You should look for God and subject to his terms of good. Not go after a human that you perceive as someone that can benefit your selfish lifestyle. And Jesus said, you know the commandments. Now, did Jesus say you need to keep the commandments to have eternal life? No. Jesus was basically rebuking this man, first by saying him, don't call a human good. Only God is good. Your attitude is wrong. And you know the commandments. So, if you know the commandments, then you must already be aware that you cannot keep those commandments. You see? Because those commandments were never given for us to follow. They were given to show us that we need Christ. What did this rich young ruler did? He asked which commandments? He was playing a fool. He already knew the commandments. He was a born Hebrew, a Judean. He grew up among the synagogue. The scribes, there's the lawyers, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, they were the rulers in that area under King Herod, which was permitted by the Roman state. So he knew the commandments. So why is he playing as stupid as if he doesn't know what Jesus is talking about? Well, Jesus named a few of the commandments. He didn't name all of them. And then that young man says, I did all of those things already. Now hold on a minute. If you claim you did all things already, then why are you there with Jesus asking, what must I do to earn eternal life? So basically, you know that you don't have eternal life. You know that you're lost. You know you're a sinner. You know you're on your way to reprobation. You know that you're in bad standing. Instead of admitting that, he was trying to, it was basically acting like a treasure hunter, someone that wanted to enrich their own lives. That's how he was set up, set up a sinner that's lost and needs salvation. And listen to what Jesus said to him. If you want to be perfect, if you sincerely want to be, because Jesus loved him, remember? If you want to be sincere, then go away, sell all you have, come here and follow me. And did Jesus say that having wealth is wrong? Did Jesus say that this wealth was his problem? No, his attitude was his problem. You see? And Jesus said you have to give up that attitude. And because of that attitude, you're holding on to all that wealth. Think that that wealth is the thing that's going to save you and that is going to sustain you. You see? And remember, he was a Hebrew. Hebrews were called Jews by the Roman state and by the Greeks. And Hebrews were not liked nor loved in the Roman Empire. They were discriminated against. So his wealth could be taken away from him and robbed from him anytime. But he didn't want to see reality. So this young man, instead of surrendering to Christ, he became bitter, offended, and sad, and he walked away. And what Christ was basically making clear here is that no man can be saved by their own merits or by their own effort. You see? Salvation is something you receive. That's why it's salvation. It's not merit. It's not meritocracy that you merit something. It's not democracy nor republicanism. It's salvation. You receive it by the Savior. And you're redeemed by the Redeemer. You're delivered by the Deliverer. Okay? And that's one reason why Jesus said that that rich people have a hard time being saved. Now, what Jesus basically is saying here that because you're rich, you cannot be saved. What Jesus basically is saying is people that have a lot of financial resources, you see, I'm talking about unbelievers now, they tend to harden themselves against the truth because they tend to give in to their illusion that they are self-sufficient. And men hold on to it despite knowing better. And they become hardened and hardened, you see. That's why when you investigate history, most of the first Christians, they were poor people, prisoners, prostitutes, people that had no merit in the Roman society. They were rejected or they were slaves. They had no legal way to go higher in the hierarchy. And so they had no, by worldly means, they had no options. They just had to take the abuse and how their lives went. But when they found Christ, they realized, I need God, and they became born again. There were wealthy people that became born again also, and they gave up their wealth to benefit the church. But many of the wealthy Romans and wealthy peoples, they rejected the gospel. And the same is happening today, guys. Some because most wealthy and rich people, they serve Satan. Whether directly by becoming a sellout, or they are worshipping Satan by rejecting the truth. They may not even know that Satan exists. They may not even want to have anything to do with him. But simply because they reject the truth, they're already in his camp. And already advancing his agenda. Even without them being aware of it. You see? And today, many of those wealthy people will even call themselves Christian. May even do philanthropy, do so-called good works to get to earn a good reputation among men. And they have this faulty pagan mindset that they can merit a good standing with God by doing all these so-called good stuff. Feeding the poor, building foster homes for foster kids. Listen, don't be fooled by all of that, guys. And that's why I said in the beginning of this video, if someone's mindset is in darkness, then everything they will look for, all their desires and their appetites are also in darkness. Even if their natural inclination, the natural, I would say like this, the natural urges will be in darkness. Sexuality, for example, someone that operates in darkness, they will use their sexuality to look for something in darkness. For example, it's common that you have people that think that sex will fulfill them. You see, that mindset is dark. So their natural urges are now being corrupted by their dark mindset. And now they are in so many sexual relationships and they never fulfilled, and they also began to harm other people. And As I shared with you, I believe it was yesterday or the day before yesterday, there was this man in America. He flipped, he lost it when his girlfriend moaned the name of her ex-husband during sex, and he basically smashed everything to pieces in the apartment. He knocked her out and he began to mutilate her and put his arm through her vagina and pulling out all her internal organs. You see, I'm repeating this, I know it's gross, but those are the things that will happen when people operate in a mindset of darkness. You see, not everyone that operates in a mindset of darkness is immediately demon possessed, but when someone operates in a mindset of darkness, you know, you can never say this individual is not capable of doing that. You see, because listen, when someone operates way too long in a mindset of darkness and they persist in it, they begin to channel evil spirits without them knowing it. They don't have to be aware of it, but they begin to channel evil spirits. So it can be that they're just walking outside and they see, for example, they see a Christian. They don't know that the individual is Christian, but they may have demons that hover around them, and those demons then will channel enter, will then work through them. May not even enter them, but the demon will work through them to verbally harass that Christian. And they don't even know why they are angry with that Christian or with that individual. They don't even know he or she is a Christian. But because they operate in darkness way too long, the demon, they are beginning to channel evil spirits. See? And many people join subcultures. And because they've joined subcultures, they now are channeling spirits also. And they're not aware that they're channeling spirits. You see? This video is a bit long, but I need to still say these things to you. For example, you have your mostly girls in their teenage years that, though to traumatic experiences, they want to resist society. They want to resist the world. And okay, they acknowledge the world is dark. They acknowledge that there's harm and all of that. They don't want all of that. They want to rebel against it. Okay. But they operate in a mindset of darkness. Okay. And they also are, that's why they're operating in accusation against the Most High. So there's a subculture where women dress only in black most of the time, sometimes in white, but mostly in black. They wear all these death symbols like a skull or skull and bones, it's also a secret society, rings that look like bones. You see, it's a gothic culture. And listen, I have nothing against people that are in the gothic scene, okay? So don't even accuse me of that. What I'm saying is, you can wear black clothes. Just like I'm wearing black now. You want to see it? Look, I'm wearing black. Also, my shoes are black. You see? So wearing black itself does not mean anything. However, when they join that subculture, it's not just about wearing black. They agree with a certain mindset of that subculture. And they confirm this by the symbols they begin to wear. And now, those symbols are just jewelry, are just a material object. But you see, look at it, just open your eyes and recognize this. You can wear a symbol, like, for example, you can wear a necklace with an apple. Okay, an apple is a natural object. Okay, there's nothing wrong with it. But a pentagram is not a natural object. The moment you begin to wear jewelry that symbolizes unnatural objects, that's basically you confirming to the evil spirits that they are welcome. Now, many of those young girls, also some of those men that join what we call the gothic scene, they're not aware of it. They're seriously not aware of it. Okay? They think, in their mind, their motivation is they want to be part of that subculture because there are a lot of parties, the mindset is a bit liberal, and there's a lot of partying, sometimes also drugs. So, as young people, it's excited. And that's the only reason they join. But they're not aware that they're giving consent to evil spirits from working through them and being attached to them. So what you will often see is, you will have those young people, especially girls, that join the gothic scene. They buy only black clothes, begin to wear the pentagram and all of that, and they feel cool. People begin to, you know, it's a subculture of being cool, of being, how do I say it, of being different, you see? However, after a few months, you will notice that those people, they become more depressed, they become isolated from people around them. They also become bitter towards even their family members and their parents. They grow worse and worse in unforgiveness, but they're not aware of it because, you know, they're under a spell. They think, well, I'm just being me. Okay, you're being you, but you joined the subculture, but never mind. Some of those people are even friendly towards others. They want to have friends, they're outgoing, all of that. Because I meet some of those people from time to time. You have a lot of them here in the Netherlands, you see. So they don't have evil intentions, but they're operating in darkness. So because they operate in darkness, it doesn't matter which good intentions they have or which healthy intentions they have, they're operating in darkness. So the result has to be wrong. The result has to be evil. You see? But that's why I'm telling you guys, many people, because they operate in a mindset of darkness, all their results are evil. All the results are evil. It's only because they don't have the discernment that they think that they're doing well. You see? That's why when you're interceding for people, pray that they'll pray for their deliverance and decree and declare their deliverance. You see? Don't pray that, okay, they will have a good house, they will have a job, and they'll be comfortable and people like them. Don't pray those satanic, disgusting prayers, okay? Pray for things that matter and things that will benefit them in the long term. That being said, you all, this video is already around 27 minutes. Well, I hope this 27 minutes has benefited you. And I'm continuing now. I'm moving on. And today is Friday, so when the sun sets, the Shabbat will begin. So for those that celebrate Shabbat, like me, Shabbat Shalom.